Allora, buon pomeriggio a tutti. Io mi chiamo Andrea Nelson Mauro, faccio parte di un team di data journalism che si chiama Dataninja. Oggi ci occupiamo di un argomento che forse non ha ancora un nome preciso, e con Federico Badaloni, che parlerà dopo di me, abbiamo avuto veramente difficoltà in questa lunga discussione che abbiamo fatto nell'ultimo anno a cercare di trovare una definizione. Quindi io spererei che venisse anche un po' fuori da questo ragionamento. Il titolo di questo talk, di questo panel, è Solutions for Constructive Journalism, e riassume alcune delle cose che stanno succedendo nel mondo del giornalismo, dell'informazione, oggi e negli ultimi anni. Da operatori del giornalismo, dell'informazione, stiamo assistendo a questi grandi, come dire, ecosistemi, ecco, che vengono creati da grandi corporation, rispetto ai quali i media tradizionali hanno sempre un po' questa, diciamo, devono rincorrere. Allora, l'idea è sostanzialmente quella di accostare questa situazione, la situazione attuale, rispetto invece ad altre cose che sono successe in passato e che hanno prodotto informazione di grandissima qualità. Pensate per esempio a Ushahidi o altri modi, metodi, strumenti, piattaforme, eventi che in qualche modo hanno generato una collaborazione collettiva, diciamo così, per produrre una soluzione a un problema. Insieme a me, che faccio un po' da maggiordomo, in realtà sono qui sostanzialmente per imparare, ci sono persone che per varie ragioni hanno una fortissima esperienza e una fortissima competenza sul tema delle infrastrutture, sul tema dell'engagement e quindi anche delle soluzioni e di questa forma, diciamo, di giornalismo costruttivo. Quindi l'idea è di dare adesso la parola a Federico, che disegnerà un po' il frame nel quale ci siamo trovati in questa lunga discussione, e poi chiedere, rispetto a questo frame e alle proprie esperienze, ai nostri ospiti, quali possono essere, diciamo, le strade di una possibile evoluzione. Capisco che come introduzione può sembrare un po' filosofica, però era forse anche un po' il nostro obiettivo, cioè mettere insieme la filosofia e la pratica, diciamo. Ok, quindi cedo la parola a Federico Badaloni, che ci disegna questo frame.
Grazie Andrea. Allora, io vado di qua. Ok. Il tentativo di mettere una cornice intorno a questa cosa è nato un anno fa. Eravamo proprio qui a Perugia con Andrea, seduti su una panchina, un po' stanchi dopo aver sentito un sacco di panel diversi, e ci siamo detti: ma non trovi anche tu che esista una spinta collettiva verso il fatto di fare qualche cosa insieme agli utenti? Siamo partiti da questo fare qualcosa. Cosa vuol dire fare qualcosa? Beh, vuol dire intanto incontrarsi, vuol dire passare da un'idea basata sulla trasmissione dell'informazione ad un'idea basata su quella del dialogo, e poi vuol dire condividere una freccia, una direzione, perché se io parlo con qualcuno e voglio costruire qualcosa con qualcuno è perché condividiamo un fine. Ora, abbiamo cominciato a scambiarci link. Vedi, guarda questa cosa, guarda quest'altra. Vedi che sono delle azioni che vengono compiute dalle testate insieme alle persone. Vedi che le persone rispondono in questo modo. Guarda, quando le persone collaborano succedono queste cose. Si sentono parte di qualcosa, e abbiamo cominciato a mettere da parte un po' di materiale. Poi abbiamo visto nascere così nell'ecosistema generale delle cose che erano all'interno di questo quadro. Appunto, solution journalism, oppure un giornalismo strutturato e così via. E allora allargavamo, verificavamo questo frame che adesso tenterò di dire. Ora, io sono un architetto dell'informazione oltre che un giornalista, per cui mi viene un po' naturale pensare in termini di ambienti, di luoghi, di ecosistemi e di sistemi. Quindi userò un po' di queste brutte parole. Allora, il primo punto che mi sembra importante sottolineare è questo. Se una testata vuole collaborare con i propri utenti, probabilmente deve imparare a capirne i bisogni. Fino ad oggi spesso il giornalismo si è basato sul fiuto. Lui sì, questo direttore, lui sì che ha fiuto per la notizia, lui sì che ha fiuto, lui sa che cosa vogliono i nostri utenti, eccetera. Oggi noi sappiamo che per fortuna alla dote del fiuto possiamo affiancare quella della ricerca etnografica, per esempio, come appunto l'architettura dell'informazione insegna, e anche l'analisi dei dati. Quindi un giornalismo che non parta da una raccolta e una valutazione ragionata dei bisogni della comunità, a mio giudizio è un giornalismo che non può partire con l'idea di collaborare. È impossibile collaborare su qualche cosa che venga imposto unilateralmente, no? Allora, una prima grande domanda è: come si fa a capire quali sono i bisogni delle persone? E secondo me il giornalismo deve ancora camminare parecchio per riuscire a rispondere in maniera strutturata, voglio dire, cioè in maniera organica alle proprie prassi redazionali, al proprio organigramma, alla propria cultura professionale, a questa domanda. Quello che mi sento di suggerire, essendo anche un laureato in antropologia culturale, in etnologia, ed essendo architetto in informazione, è che in realtà da molti anni lo user experience design e l'architettura informazione lavorano alla raccolta dei bisogni degli utenti tramite la ricerca etnografica. Quindi esistono delle metodologie che a mio giudizio vanno portate in redazione perché danno ottimi frutti. Tanto per dirla succintamente, una ricerca etnografica è una ricerca molto più qualitativa che quantitativa, mentre oggi siamo abituati a ragionare in termini di ricerche quantitative. È una ricerca che non tiene assolutamente in conto l'idea di utente medio, perché come ci ha insegnato Clay Shirky, all'interno di un ecosistema che è basato su una struttura di rete reticolare, la legge che governa l'articolazione dei gruppi umani e la distribuzione delle informazioni è una legge di potenza, in cui non conta l'utente medio, perché più aumenta la audience di un sito o di un giornale, più gli utenti tendono a polarizzarsi e a radunarsi in gruppi di interesse. E quindi ecco perché serve una ricerca etnografica in grado di restituire, come si fa, come si faceva quando si andava nel territorio a studiare delle popolazioni di posti lontani, di restituire appunto l'articolazione interna dei gruppi umani che ruotano intorno alla propria testata. Il secondo punto importante, a questo punto abbiamo capito quali sono i bisogni, facciamo delle scelte. Come giornalisti facciamo delle scelte, perché noi non siamo lì per risolvere tutti i bisogni, ovviamente. E quindi una prima azione che, se volete, è di natura civica o politica, se possiamo usare questo termine, è quello della scelta dei bisogni di cui tu come testata decidi di occuparti, no? E che cosa vuol dire occuparsi? Definire quali azioni puoi fare. Allora, in base a cosa decidi? Allora, chiaramente in base alla tua vocazione, alla tua identità, alla tua storia, ma devi pure decidere in base ai mezzi che hai, quali tecnologie puoi usare, quanto budget hai, quanto tempo hai, no? Quante professionalità interne hai. Allora, questo secondo aspetto è, possiamo definirlo una ricerca interna. Per affrontare questo secondo aspetto, dico meglio, è necessaria lo stesso tipo di approccio che usavamo all'esterno con una ricerca etnografica è necessario all'interno, nel rapporto con gli stakeholders, nel rapporto con i colleghi. E spesso anche qui il giornalismo non ha sviluppato al suo interno degli strumenti di co-working, di collaborazione, di lavoro interdisciplinare, che sono quelli anche necessari in una fase di ricerca per capire cosa è sostenibile, cosa riusciamo veramente a fare a livello di azione. Guardate che noi non ci poniamo più questa domanda, perché finché il problema è reporting, o scrivere il pezzo, tutto quello che sto dicendo ha meno senso, o meglio, è già inserito in una prassi di lavoro. Se invece dobbiamo compiere un'azione corale, collettiva con i nostri utenti, guardare al nostro interno e capire di cosa siamo effettivamente poi capaci, significa individuare qual è quel crinale sottile fra il successo e il fallimento di questa collaborazione con gli utenti. Bene, a questo punto abbiamo identificato, questi sono i bisogni, immaginate un grande insieme di bisogni, 50 bisogni, noi abbiamo detto ci occupiamo di questi 5. E come ci occupiamo di questi 5? Con queste possibili azioni. A questo punto serve un luogo, servono dei luoghi. Perché servono dei luoghi? Perché quando, ecco, noi siamo qui in questa stanza, perché vogliamo in un certo senso collaborare, vogliamo trovarci, vogliamo poter dialogare, no? Vogliamo costruire qualcosa in questo momento che passiamo adesso, e ognuno sta condividendo le risorse più preziose che ha, che sono il tempo della propria vita e lo spazio. Allora, per riuscire a condividere risorse, siano esse conoscenza, tempo, energie, servono luoghi. Ora, il giornalismo classico, cioè se volete quello di prima della rete, non si pone questo problema perché il luogo esiste. È il giornale di carta, è il telegiornale, la radio. Invece noi ci troviamo nelle condizioni di dover costruire il luogo migliore per ogni azione che vogliamo intraprendere con gli utenti. Quando Orio Collo non riesce più a tenere dietro alle incursioni armate nelle bande del Kenya, no? E chiede aiuto ad una comunità di sviluppatori, nasce Ushahidi, ma Ushahidi è nato per fare quel tipo di reporting in quel tipo di ecosistema, parlo di ecosistema proprio fisico, in cui esistono i cellulari, sono molto diffusi, ma magari internet di meno, bisogna mettere insieme queste cose, e quindi nasce quel tipo di luogo. Perché un luogo? Quali sono le caratteristiche di un luogo? Un luogo è accogliente, quindi è aperto, le persone possono collaborare. Un luogo è persistente, e questa è una seconda grande cosa disruptive rispetto al giornalismo tradizionale, che è basato sull'effimero. Io oggi ti dico una cosa e poi domani te ne dico un'altra e dopodomani un'altra ancora. La persistenza del luogo è quello che ti garantisce di poterti incontrare con qualcuno e sederti e lavorarci insieme. E se tu questo luogo lo devi progettare per ogni cosa che vuoi fare, per ogni azione che vuoi compiere, ecco che diventa importante la competenza della costruzione dei luoghi. L'architettura dell'informazione e lo user experience design fanno questo, costruiscono dei luoghi, tant'è vero che come architetto dell'informazione costruisco i siti e le applicazioni del gruppo editoriale L'Espresso, ed è chiaro che il sito del National Geographic che progetto è diverso dal nuovo sito che stiamo rifacendo di Repubblica IT, ed è diverso dal sito di Le Scienze o dall'applicazione per trovare il cinema. Ma queste cose sono luoghi digitali. E qui c'è un'altra cosa che mi permetto di seminare a beneficio di coloro che poi in maniera molto più concreta parleranno dopo di me, che questi luoghi non sono più solo digitali, come i siti per esempio, sono sempre più commisti. Pensate, non so, ad una stazione, pensate ad un ospedale, pensate alle stesse, a quanto si, pensate al, per esempio a un'applicazione per vedere gli autobus di Perugia. Bene, voi avete bisogno di certe informazioni quando state in giro per Perugia e avete questo in mano. Quello stesso set di informazioni si manifesta ai vostri sensi in maniera molto diversa quando state seduti dentro casa e dovete pianificare lo spostamento dalla vostra casa alla stazione. Eppure è sempre lo stesso set di informazioni. Ecco quindi che il passaggio importante è che noi possiamo avere una matrice di dati, una matrice di informazioni, ma dobbiamo essere capaci di articolare queste matrici in luoghi differenti per obiettivi differenti, per compiere delle azioni differenti, e ci vogliono degli skill specifici. Ora, quando abbiamo individuato i bisogni, individuato le soluzioni, le azioni che possiamo compiere e gli ambienti dove fare tutto questo, quindi le nostre cassette degli attrezzi, ecco che possiamo agire. Ora questa azione produce dati. E qui cominciamo a chiudere questo cerchio come in una forma dialettica hegeliana, no? Cioè chiudiamo questo cerchio. Io collaboro con una persona, propongo un oggetto, propongo un dato, propongo un'informazione. Questa interazione con la persona ridefinisce questo dato, lo arricchisce, lo sposta, me lo fa vedere da un altro punto di vista. Semplicemente l'atto stesso di interagire produce nuovi dati. Quante persone hanno interagito? Per quanto tempo? Per fare cosa? Con che intenzione? Se sono molto bravo posso andare a fare l'analisi del sentiment, no? di tutto quello che è avvenuto in queste interazioni e così via. Questi dati non possono evaporare. Questi dati sono ciò su cui io posso costruire business. Quindi il possesso di questi dati, no, fa sì che io imparo qualcosa e lo cristallizzo e ne dispongo, ok? Alla fine di questa azione collettiva fatta con le persone, magari siamo riusciti a cambiare qualcosa nel reale. Abbiamo compiuto un'azione, questa azione ha avuto degli esiti. Allora qui può esserci una funzione classica del giornalismo, che è quello di raccontare quello che abbiamo fatto. Siamo riusciti a far passare questa legge, siamo riusciti a ripulire i giardini pubblici della città e così via. Quindi c'è una fase di reporting di ciò che si è compiuto insieme. E questa fase di reporting in un certo senso ha cambiato la realtà e quindi siamo pronti per ricominciare questo ciclo e dire ok, adesso forse quei bisogni non ci sono più, adesso forse ce ne sono degli altri e questo ciclo ricomincia. Questo è il frame che io ho individuato per inquadrare la discussione di oggi. A questo punto mi sono fatto una domanda piuttosto semplice. Questa cosa che ho descritto non può avvenire così, nell'aria, deve avvenire in qualche posto. Ora, dove avviene? Avviene in una piattaforma e la domandina semplice semplice è quella scritta lassù. Chi possiede la piattaforma? Di chi è? Se tutto questo, per esempio, è avvenuto, o parti di queste, di tutto questo sono avvenute su Facebook, quella cosa scritta lì, data, collect data, come la facciamo? Di chi sono quei dati? A chi li chiediamo? Se le persone hanno interagito con noi in una piattaforma terza, al di là di Facebook, qualunque cosa, noi ci ha fatto comodo perché magari non avevamo budget per svilupparla una piattaforma per fare tutto questo, ma ci siamo posti il problema di riuscire poi a trarre un valore, non soltanto il capitale fiduciario, perché quello resta il capitale di fiducia che riusciamo a costruire con i nostri utenti facendo queste operazioni, è fondamentale, perché se riusciamo a collaborare con le persone, a compiere delle azioni incisive sul territorio, le persone avranno fiducia in noi e noi potremo dire a queste persone sostienici. Quindi questo rimane come capitale, ma io sto parlando di qualche cosa che ci arricchisce perché ci offre dei nuovi spunti, ci fa fare il lavoro con meno sforzo al prossimo giro in cui metteremo in pista delle soluzioni. Ora, è chiaro che noi fino ad oggi abbiamo avuto come giornalisti delle piattaforme atte a trasmettere. Quindi primo grosso shift è passare da una piattaforma di trasmissione a una piattaforma che serve per condividere risorse e per collaborare. L'altro grosso spostamento è passare da un giornalismo dell'istante, e qui volutamente sto facendo, diciamo così, una sorta di allusione agli instant articles, che ha senso in un certo tempo, in un certo minuto, perché ha bruciato il concorrente, perché sono arrivato prima, ad un giornalismo. Perché tutto questo sia possibile, dico, poi non voglio dire che il giornalismo deve smettere di fare un reporting istantaneo delle cose, però sto dicendo che se vogliamo compiere questo tipo di giornalismo dobbiamo anche avere la capacità di lavorare sulla lunga durata, su una condivisione durevole e su una collaborazione, e quindi dobbiamo produrre dei contenuti durevoli che non svaniscono dopo che li abbiamo prodotti. E questa durevolezza, questo rimanere nel tempo è il fondamento per la fiducia. Se ci pensate, noi abbiamo fiducia in una persona che conosciamo. Non so, se io oggi incontro Andrea posso dire è simpatico, ho fiducia in lui istintivamente, ma se, come mi accade, lo conosco da diversi anni, la mia fiducia nei suoi confronti sarà molto più solida. A questo serve costruire ambienti, luoghi e contenuti durevoli. E quindi anche forse le azioni e le soluzioni che abbiamo trovato lavorando con i nostri utenti dovrebbero essere scelte in funzione della loro capacità di durare. Ora, quindi questa piattaforma, come vedete in questo schema che ho fatto, in realtà è la matrice di cui parlavo, perché contiene i dati, contiene questi contenuti che durano, ed è una matrice dalla quale noi possiamo derivare dei luoghi di azione, che possono essere dei luoghi per la mobilità, dei luoghi fisici. Pensate, non so, al Guardian che sta costruendo proprio un posto fisico, un enorme padiglione dove si incontra con le persone, oppure dei siti, o dei giornali, anche un giornale è un luogo di incontro, con delle caratteristiche particolari, no? Perché ha una comunicazione asincrona. Però, ok, quindi, e vado a chiudere, se i media digitali che incrementano la quantità e la qualità della partecipazione alla vita comunitaria delle persone, del loro senso civico, incrementano allo stesso tempo la percezione del potere che queste persone hanno. C'è un termine molto bello in inglese che noi non abbiamo, che è to empower, no? Cioè dare il potere, mettere le persone nelle condizioni di avere un potenziale. E poiché tutto questo accada e sia concretamente vissuto come un'esperienza, cioè vuol dire come esperienza, vuol dire che i nostri sensi devono darcene cognizione, non servono siti o qualsiasi altro modello di rappresentazione delle informazioni, servono piattaforme, cioè luoghi, e quando questi luoghi sono articolati e sono cross-canali, sono ecosistemi. La funzione di questi ecosistemi è il bene comune. Questa sembra un'affermazione così un po' filosofica, ma le persone non collaborano con noi se non hanno la percezione di stare facendo qualcosa per un bene comune. E questo è, a mio giudizio, esattamente il pilastro su cui costruire l'alternativa al modello Instant Articles, perché è un'alternativa dove il concetto di rilevanza, di ciò che è rilevante, noi giornalisti siamo quelli che individuano ciò che è rilevante, ok? È calcato, è aderente a ciò che noi reputiamo essere il bene comune. Mentre se ci pensate, l'algoritmo, che è un robot di Facebook, non può che far coincidere il concetto di rilevanza, di cosa è rilevante, con l'interesse individuale. Cioè mi fa vedere nella mia bacheca quello che interessa a me, ma non quello che è importante che io veda, anche se in quel momento magari penso che non mi interessi. Questa è una cosa che rimarrà specifica dell'essere umano e quindi rimarrà l'anima del giornalismo. Ora, se per riuscire a sostenere il nostro lavoro dovremo anche fare dei contenuti per Facebook, no? Ma la strada che passa per la costruzione di luoghi permanenti, di piattaforme, è la strada che potrà costruire un modello alternativo al giornalismo dell'istante, al giornalismo del fai il tuo contenuto e vattene. Il giornalismo basato sui luoghi e sulla collaborazione è fai un tuo contenuto e resta qui ad accudirlo, ad annaffiarlo, a condividerlo e ad accrescerlo grazie al lavoro di tutta la comunità che crede che questa cosa sia un bene comune.
Io trovo estremamente profondo questo ragionamento ed è uno di quei ragionamenti che mi fa proprio innamorare, diciamo, delle idee, delle persone che io non sarei in grado di fare, ma è comunque parziale. Una cosa che ci siamo detti con Federico è che questo è un pezzo del tutto, non è il tutto, può essere un inizio, una fine, una considerazione su una serie di esperienze. Una parola che va pronunciata assolutamente da subito, e come già fatto lui, è la parola business, perché che siano gli Instant Articles o che siano altre cose, comunque tutto questo mondo si regge sul fatto che ci sia un business model. Il discorso sui needs ricorda il Value Proposition Canvas. Quindi qual è il valore che offre la tua iniziativa, qual è il problema che risolvi? Sono tutte cose che oggi chi diciamo, si informa nel mondo delle start-up, delle imprese, del giornalismo, eccetera, conosce perfettamente. Allora, il primo punto che ci interessava approfondire, non ci sono domande a sorpresa, state tranquilli, il primo punto che ci interessava approfondire era connesso a una questione etica, e qui chiamerò Andrew. Ci deve essere un'etica nel modo in cui si costruisce o si favorisce la nascita di questo ecosistema, e lo chiediamo a Andrew perché tra le varie cose che ha fatto nella sua lunga carriera si occupa da tanti anni di engagement, e quindi si è trovato di fronte a dei problemi che ha dovuto risolvere di volta in volta. Come here or say
there? Do you want me to do my deck?
Right? Yes. Sure. Okay. I don't know if it's gonna speak to
you.
Can
stay here,
can stay here or
okay. No. I have a few slides.
Yeah. Okay.
You don't know if that's gonna speak directly to the ethics, but a part of it will.
Okay.
Yes.
Good. See.
Thank you, Federico and Andrea. I also want to thank everyone for showing up. I respect your stamina for the last few days. I also want to take this time to also thank the organizers, Ariana and Chris. I think they've done a phenomenal job of putting this together. And since this is going to be my last one, I got to leave tomorrow morning. I just want to take the time to thank the organizers and all the staff to make this all happen. When we first started talking in a little bit about, you know, is there a definition? I totally agree that there's been different ways we've been defining this. You call it constructive journalism, you know, at our school, or at least some of the organizations I've been working with, we've been thinking about it as engaged journalism, especially when we're thinking about our community. You know, instead of using the ideas of audience, I always like to think of them as the community of the public that we're trying to engage with. So it'd be interesting to kind of help think about it in that form. Just to back up a little bit, I'm Andrew DeVigal. I'm the chair in journalism innovation and civic engagement at the Agora Journalism Center, which is a part of the University of Oregon's School of Journalism and Communication. And I put up quickly this slide that pulls in a little bit of our mission statement at Agora. And what it says is that we truly, as a center, seek to articulate the vision and practice of journalism that is inextricably linked to the health of our democracy. So when we think about our commitment to the public and our commitment to the community, they go hand in hand with what we convey in terms of stories and information. And some of the visuals I'm gonna share and some of the insights I'm gonna share, especially in thinking about the ethics of engagement, really kind of comes from a thinking that we had a few months ago in October of 2015 from a conference that we had called Experience Engagement. And what we did at Experience Engagement, and again, this was a conference that we produced in collaboration with another organization by the name of Journalism That Matters. And they're really just an amazing organization that's been thinking about how do we look at the future and reimagine what journalism might be. The executive director there is Peggy Holman, who's a master of convenings and putting people together and looking at the core purpose of communities. And so we had a chance to get together with a group of over 100 journalists, civic leaders, community members, those practicing in the engagement space. And so we got together for 3.5 days, no panels, which is truly an open space conference. And the thing that came out of that convening was this attempt for this definition, this idea that engagement, and again, that term has been used a lot during this conference, and that it has varied, and we'll show a little bit of that variance, that engagement is about authentic connections, valuing people and mutual exchanges so that what's best for individuals and the community as a whole emerges. So in context of that, when I think about our journalism, it's really revolving around this definition. So the ethics of engagement that you were asking about, right? So this is something that if you attended our session yesterday in the morning, this was a concept that Mike Fancher shared, who was our founding director at the Agora Journalism Center. And he has such a deep, rich background in ethics. He was a journalist for 20 years, or no, for 30 years. 20 years of those was the executive editor at the New York Times, where he won 4 Pulitzers. So he has such a knowledge of the legacy media, but yet still has the innovative vision to think about this power of the tradition norms and the emerging values of what we're trying to explore here. And even though the arrows represent some transition, I think what's important is to think of that these emerging values is more of an and, right? It's this idea that it's not an or, it's not the tyranny of the or, but really it's the genius of the and of combining the traditional norms with emerging values. So you spoke a little bit about the word empower, right? So in an earlier conference that we had, you know, we traditionally have seen journalism as speaking truth to empower or to power. But in one of the conferences that we had, one of our young professors said, you know, is it evolving to becoming more speaking truth to empower? And we've always talked about objectivity and neutrality. Is there a way to think about engagement that has empathy and inclusion? I mean, you know, I really value Federico's chart, you know, because it reminds me deeply about the design thinking process, right? And this idea of identifying and collecting and evaluating community needs is very much akin to the empathy process in the IDEO version of design thinking, right? The very first process, the very first chart. So this idea of empathy and inclusion, I think, is gonna be key to the way we think about in the emerging values of what we're trying to do, especially through journalism. And then also the idea of independence, right? The traditional norms of independence that we are separate from the whole. You know, the one challenge in taking that on is the fact that, you know, we live in a world where everyone's interconnected, that everyone has the ability to distribute information in real time. So I don't want to belabor that much because that's been a discussion that we've had all weekend in terms of the power of the smartphones nowadays being able to empower anyone to be able to speak one to many, right? And then the idea of giving voice to the voiceless has, again, been a lot of the things that I still hear from journalism schools, where that's why I got into journalism is because I want to give voice to the voiceless. But the more I work with community, the more they remind me is that they have a voice. It's just that we're not listening, right? And what they really want is a platform to be shared, right? To be able to be in the same level to be heard. So how can we help find that platform and also use their own voice, empower them to tell their story? And then finally, this concept of journalism for people is rather looking at journalism with people. How do we co-create with that in a way that is meaningful? And again, goes back to the purpose of what we're trying to do in terms of, are we giving enough of the stories and information so that citizens can leave a thriving life in a democracy. So one of the things that came out of the experience engagement also conference is this idea of the intermixing of communities and journalism. And, you know, again, Federico talked a little bit about the ecosystem, right? This is this platform. And I love that concept because this merging, and let me just talk through a little bit of what this chart's saying, is that in the blue circle is the term journalism, right? It's this idea of journalism, and the left is being communities in green. And as the circles grow, both in journalism and as well as communities, the intersection of engagement deepens, right? And, you know, one of the things at the Agora Journalism Center that we really truly believe in is that I think this is an exciting time for journalism, because I think the success of it is that what we will see when this sort of new journalism comes about in some ways is that there will be more journalism being done by more people on more platforms. And this, if we can kind of accept that and look at this Venn diagram as an opportunity to do that, you know, how do we get there, right? How do we, for example, strengthen the journalism engagement capacity? How can we get more news organizations and to create structures, right, in terms of this digital space that Federico was talking about? How do we create structures for doing more engaged journalism, or maybe more constructed journalism? And then on the community side is, how can we become stewards, and not us being stewards, because again, the community has a voice, but it's really about strengthening the capacity for community's well-being, right? Developing storytellers with our community, involving the youth, collaborating with the artists. So as the growth of this platform, as the platform expands, this evolution of a civic communication ecosystem is the possibility. So second last slide I was thinking about was this idea of how do we define these levels of engagement, right? And I'm gonna lift this one directly from Gideon Rosenblatt. He's drawn this one engagement pyramid. I've inverted it a little bit because of, you know, I still am a journalist, so I inverted the pyramid in terms of the six levels of connecting with people in social, and his title was really looking at people and social changes, right? How do we, from the start, look and observing? And I think we've been practicing journalism in some ways at the first step, right? Observing. And if we kind of think about how we kind of up or go to the levels of engagement by following and then ultimately endorsing, right? When you say following, that could be a metric of what we would consider as following that feed or following, you know, that Twitter stream. And then endorsing is, in some ways, commenting on the stories or maybe even retweeting it because you're endorsing it in some ways. Contributing is where I think a lot of things are happening right now, where a lot of the public is contributing content or even potential to those stories. So there's been exciting work that's being shared this weekend about that. Now, the idea of owning and leading, I think, is where we're pushing the boundaries on, and what would that look like? And I would love to try to explain that with you guys, explore that with you guys, what that might look like in terms of owning and leading. But there's been some really innovative projects that's coming around. Bristol Cables, for example, is one that quickly comes to mind in terms of the community owning their stories, the community owning that media, right? So it's community stories by the community. So there are some really great examples of this kinds of levels of engagement happening. And then finally, how do we interact those levels of engagement with the Venn diagram that we've explored? So I think that was pretty much what I wanted to share. And I'm hoping that kind of answered a little bit of your question, Andrea. But but hopefully we'll add that to the rest of the Q&A. So thank you.
Grazie Andrew. In questo percorso l'esperienza di Samantha e di Cathrine si, a nostro giudizio, si collocano perfettamente. Io comincerò chiedendo di venire qui, comincerò chiedendolo a Samantha, che lavora in un team che in un progetto che si chiama Solutions Journalism ha una esperienza accademica e loro fanno anche dei progetti, diciamo, di training e quindi conoscono le problematicità, le criticità che ci possono essere nel diffondere i loro contenuti, perché c'è una grande domanda di, forse anche un po' inespressa, una grande domanda di metodo su come capire questi bisogni e come provare a risolverli. Allora, loro in America stanno costruendo un percorso lungo, è un team molto, molto ampio, o almeno da quello che io ho visto è un team molto ampio, e adesso Samantha ci potrà raccontare la propria esperienza e cercare di dare uno spunto in questo contesto. Okay?
Okay, grazie Andrea. I'm very excited and very honored to be here. These are questions I love to think about, and they really kind of fill in what I've been thinking about for the past few days and the incredible people I've seen on panels and the really deep discussions about everything related to engagement and what we're actually producing, what kind of journalism lends itself well to engagement, to working with communities and hearing their stories and making a better society. So I'm from the Solutions Journalism Network, and we are a nonprofit organization. We're based in New York, and our mission is to legitimize and spread the practice of solutions journalism. So this is rigorous reporting about how people are responding to problems. So there's this mentality in journalism, you all know it, if it bleeds, it leads. We think that leaves out quite a few stories. Someone was mentioning on a panel a few days ago that it's about news, it's about new, not news. And so it's, you know, the deviation is what we highlight. And there's so many incredible things going on, so many incredible people and programs working on really entrenched problems across the world that don't get coverage because of this misperception about how we should cover things that are working or partially working. So in practice, what is solutions journalism? So this is US-based, apologies. A tale of two cities. You have Chicago, Illinois, and you have Fayetteville, North Carolina. They both have very high crime rates. In Chicago, it's violent crime. I think I saw something last week that crime is up 75% compared to the first few months of last year. It's high homicide and robbery and rape. It's terrible. And Fayetteville has very high rates of larceny and burglary and property crimes. So the two papers took two different approaches. The Chicago Tribune created a series called Under the Gun. It documented how gun violence shocks and destabilizes neighborhoods. It was an incredible series. It was beautiful. It was a photo essay. Compelling, emotional, just absolutely heart-wrenching. That's one approach. The Fayetteville Observer, which is a family-owned newspaper, took a different approach. Over the course of a year, there was a reporter and editor duo, Greg Barnes and Mike Adams. They reported one long in-depth feature a month on how different cities in the Southeast were responding to issues and problems that Fayetteville also faced. The reporter Greg went to 13 cities over 13 cities and 7 states over the course of a year, and created this incredible series about, you know, dealing with blight and poverty and how police were responding and how schools were involved, and it was comprehensive and has resulted in the beginnings of a formation of a collective impact board really bringing literally to the table people who have been at ads for a decade. You know, Mike, I went down there and the editor, I said, Mike, why did you frame it this way? He said, you can't do another series about how terrible everything is. He's like, my readers won't buy it. They don't want to read it. It's not going to do anything. So when you're thinking about a solutions journalism, it's really, really important to know what it's not. So you feel that it's okay to do. So we have seven imposters. We call them imposters. The first one is hero worship. These are stories that look at what an individual is doing. The work that they're doing, kind of, you know, their life story, and they're really inspiring, but they don't have insights. They don't have information that other people who might work in similar areas can learn from. It's purely inspirational. In solutions journalism stories, the hero is the idea. Of course, you're never going to worship an idea, but the core of the story is about the program that they're working on. It's about the response that they're involved in. And this one is especially interesting because it's looking at the incredible program that she leads, but it's taking it from the angle of her. Silver bullet. So these are stories that have terrible leads. This is from the New York Times. I'm sorry, New York Times, you do so much good stuff. So sometimes a soccer ball is more than just a ball. Sometimes it's a lifesaver. Okay, that's garbage. A ball is never a lifesaver. Solutions journalism deals with really complex problems like poverty and homelessness and racism and economic development, and a ball isn't going to solve any one problem. And no one, even if it's one program, it's not going to solve one problem. It's all looking at a piece of a problem and what one response is doing to address that. Favor for a friend. So these are basically thinly veiled PR pieces. You're regurgitating a press release. There's no caveats. There's no to be sure paragraph. And think tank stories, these propose solutions or responses that actually haven't been implemented yet. So it's all kind of theoretical. It's saying this is what we should do. This is what we could do. Solutions journalism is reporting on things that are happening today. You're reporting the news, good or bad. If it's working or not, it's already happening. It's in place. The House I Live In was this really great documentary looking at, it was a scathing critique of the criminal justice system in America and the inequity and the money behind it and the racism and inequality. And the last 4 minutes, 4 to 6 minutes, I should be generous, looked at, oh yeah, and there are some people responding to these things too. It was thrown in as an afterthought. There's no serious consideration to the numerous organizations and individuals working to solve the exact issues, exact problems that the movie was talking about. Instant activist. So this is probably the most conflated concept we get, that journalists think we're asking them to get involved in issues or to click on a button at the bottom of a story or to donate $5 or to join a Facebook group, and it's not. And it's different from engagement, right? It's different from engaging your readers. This is direct activism, and we're never asking you to do that. And there's no word for empower. I don't know if crispy bacon will translate in Italian, but these are heartwarming, wonderful, lovely, soft, cute stories about pigs in wheelchairs, you know, thrown in at the end of a nightly news segment, but they're not serious journalism. They're not dealing with the huge issues we're talking about, the huge problems we need to address. So additionally, solutions journalism, it's a practice. It's a thing you do. It's a tool in your toolkit. It's one way of approaching a story. It's not always going to be appropriate. You know, there's a time for it, and that time is when there's an incredible amount of awareness and there's outrage. So people know there's a problem and they agree that something has to be done with it. They have all this energy, this kind of pent-up energy and fury that why hasn't something been done to address this? And then you have the solution story kind of there as an outlet for a way to move forward, for other people to learn from. It's not a movement, it's not civic journalism or public journalism or You know, we're not asking journalists to get involved with reporters or to have journalists to get involved with the community or have the community be the reporters. It's just a way of reporting a story. So these are the four core tenets. I told you what it wasn't. This is what it is. It features not just a person, but a response to a problem and how it happened. And the how is key. You really want every little detail, how it happened, what the person did next. That can create the narrative tension that can really make it a strong, compelling story. Solutions journalism stories, they provide available evidence. So you're not just looking at someone's intentions. You're not saying, aren't they nice? They got involved in this program. And then we won't look at the results. You're looking at the results, you're finding evidence when you can find it, qualitative or quantitative. It's rigorous, it's, I call it policy analysis for dummies. It's, you know, they're great stories. They produce insights that can help others respond, so it's really getting that information about why a program worked or didn't. And then it discusses limitations. There are always caveats, or you're not afraid to include them, rather. Sometimes there aren't. Sometimes a program is just really working well. So SJN, we're based out of New York, and we engage in three ways. We have led 56 newsrooms across the country in trainings, doing core workshops with them, working with them on projects, short-term, long-term, anything from 3 months to 3 years. We're now entering our third year with the Seattle Times Education Lab project. It's a phenomenal series looking at how people in the Pacific Northwest are responding to challenges in public education. Online learning platform, we create lots of tools. I have a couple toolkits up here. It's everything you need to know about how to do this kind of reporting rigorously, how to bring it into your newsroom, how to edit these stories, how to pitch them, how to, you know, obstacles you might encounter. And then finally, we have the network side. And this is offline chapters in cities across the US. We're in four cities right now, hopefully expanding internationally soon. But it's really connecting and supporting the work that you're doing. These are some of the organizations we work with. So we do everything from print, legacy media, new media, radio, video, across beats, across topic issues. And then, so journalists, this, like, why are we here? Why is this needed? Why haven't these stories been written about at the scale that they probably should have been? Journalists think of themselves as whistleblowers. They hold power to account. They expose wrongdoing. And what's the theory behind that? That once you expose these kind of problems, society will be compelled to respond, to answer them, to address them, change will happen. But it doesn't always work that way, as we know. This is a Supreme Court Justice Brandeis. Sunlight is said to be the best of disinfectants. So if you shine light on a problem, it will clean the problem, right? It will erase it, it will absolve it. We like to think of journalism more as guide dog rather than watchdog. Really taking that energy, as I mentioned before, and translating it into action, showing people what's already going on, showing people and audiences that there are already people responding to this and that they don't have to shut off from the news. Like this is a huge problem, the negativity of the news and people completely disengaging from it. And when they see effective responses to problems, audiences are much more likely to continue engaging. And we've done lots of A/B testing with that and seeing how readers consume solution stories different than problem stories. And then this is something I've been thinking about the past few days over the conference, is that the concept of innovation, we seem to conflate with Snapchat. That this is kind of the sole framing for how we think about how to move forward. It's the delivery mechanism. It's how people are consuming their news. It's how it's delivered, but it's not what is being delivered. I feel like we're doing a disservice to to our audiences when we focus on how a story can be delivered, whether it's podcast or radio and video, and yes, these are all wonderful new things, but there's very little focus on content and on how people engage with what story you're actually writing, or really how they're disengaging from it. I'm gonna skip that. So Education Lab, this is our third year partnership with them. They've done stories on, or rather studies on how readers of Education Lab consume the news and their response to it. And they're more likely to share content, they're more likely to engage with content, to read about another story in the same issue afterwards. And then this echoes a study that we did at the Solutions Journalism Network with the Engaging News Project at UT Austin. Readers of solution stories are much more likely to feel inspired or optimistic after reading an article. They're much more likely to read articles from the same newspaper, from the same reporter, and that really says a lot when you're talking about building audiences and building followings if you're an independent. They're much more likely to get involved in working toward a solution. They're more likely to share the article. They spend, we just had a study released, they spend between 10 and 25% more on solution stories that are the same length as the problem story, so more time on story. So if you're a journalist and you're excessively cynical, Cathrine says, when you say critical, always critical.
Never cynical.
Always critical, never cynical. So if you're excessively cynical, that's treated as a misdemeanor when you're a journalist, okay? It's like, oh, well, he was just being cautious, you know, she didn't want to try to sell it too much, that's fine. But if you're excessively gullible, if you buy into something that turns out to be, you know, a complete failure, that's a felony. And this is a metaphor. It's not actually illegal. There have been misunderstandings before with that. But solutions journalism is a way to reduce that risk. It's if you don't overclaim, if you're honest about existing evidence, if you're honest about what's actually happening on the ground and don't make predictions for the future, you know, it reduces this risk that your credibility will be undermined. So how do you do this? You're reporting a story or you're framing an investigative series. Say, who's doing it better? You know, you write the 500-word piece, you write the 1,000-word piece. You say, okay, did I do a service to my readers? Did I give them the whole story? That's kind of our tagline, it's the whole story. Are you giving your readers a picture of what's actually happening? And I think there's also this conflating of terms between accuracy and faithfulness. Are the stories you read today in most legitimate news outlets, are they accurate? Absolutely, usually. Are they faithful, though? Are they giving a complete picture of what's actually going on in relation to that issue? Maybe not. And then for editors, it's talking about a shift in coverage. You're gonna have to let go of some of the fluffier stories, some of the shorter stories, maybe some more breaking news, and really invest in these kind of stories that take a little bit more time to do, but they're meaty and they engage audiences and they create better communities. That's all. Okay.
Grazie, Samantha. Io spero che Cathrine mi perdoni per averla chiamata per ultima, però diciamo il tema del giornalismo che informa con soluzioni positive a problemi è oggetto del lavoro di ricerca che Cathrine fa in Europa, in Olanda, e specialmente, in special modo, lei si occupa di una scuola di giornalismo ed è una ricercatrice un tema nuovo rispetto alle nostre, almeno alle mie competenze, alle mie conoscenze, e parliamo di constructive journalism. La parte di Cathrine si ricollega anche al discorso fatto da Samantha e da Andrew, anche perché c'è un'influenza positiva nelle buone notizie. Non vorrei promuovere il giornale delle buone notizie o cose di questo tipo che abbiamo già sentito. Vorrei che Cathrine condividesse la sua esperienza rispetto alle ricerche che ha fatto e anche alcune esperienze che in Europa ci sono. Ok?
So I'm gonna take it right back to the engagement, which is why we have this panel. Because I used to be, or I am still a news reporter. I had a long career in news, in Danish broadcasting. I'm a Danish national. But something happened when I worked in the US reporting on the economical recession. I was interviewing a homeless woman who had lost her job in her home. And during this interview for a news piece, this woman started to talk about how she had grown, what she had learned from it, from losing her job and her home. And suddenly the interview went in a whole other direction than I thought. I thought I was there to interview a so-called victim. Then she started to talk about this, and I was fascinated about these, you could say, hidden information that she had. And I then chose to take that those part of the interview back into my story that I did for Danish broadcasting, it was radio. And what happened after the story was broadcasted is the reason why I am now working full-time in constructive journalism. Because the responses that I got on this specific radio piece that I did was overwhelming. After 13 years in news reporting, you rarely hear from anyone. You hear from maybe someone in power who's unhappy about what you've been doing, or an organization who's invested in your story, but rarely do you hear from the public, the real people out there. But after this story had been broadcast, I got 11, 12 emails from listeners who said, there was something about this piece that really, really made me stop and listen. It engaged me. And I remember thinking, okay, there's something for journalism here to understand. We need to find out what was specifically about this story that seemingly engaged the viewers in a different way than the classical stories that I've been doing. So I started to dig into the psychology and what emotions engages people and disengages people. So when we have this panel, I think it's actually quite innovative and controversial. And I would like to ask you who are here to listen, how many of you, if you went back to your newsrooms or to the colleagues you work with in journalism, would find it controversial that we need to engage and co-create with our audiences? I would like to get a sense of how many of them would say it's controversial to do this. Raise your hand. Yeah, a few? Because it is a controversial topic, but there's a lot of potential in it. So this new year, something extraordinary happened, I think. The Windesheim University in the Netherlands, we can go back to it, want me to build an institute for constructive journalism where we use this research into psychology to inform how we do journalism. And in this presentation, I want to share some of the results, and I also want to share some really hands-on examples. But just to give you an idea of what I do at Windesheim, we teach, we do trainings with newsrooms, we teach the students constructive journalism. Next thing we're doing is we're researching, and the research is based in behavioral sciences, not classical journalistic research, you could say, but moral psychology, positive psychology, other domains in behavioral sciences. We really look into what emotions engages people. How can you use that into the way you report? Does that create more interaction, empowerment, and how can we build on that? And the last part we do at Windesheim is building the network. So if any of you sit here and wanna connect and work with us on this or are just interested in what's going on, I hope you will grab one of the handouts that I put there on the corner. It's a sample of a book I've written, and it also had my has my contact information. So please join up into this work. We're trying to establish the best possible network around it. But of course, there are some pink elephants around this whole approach into journalism. And I think for this panel, the biggest pink elephant, I think, is does journalism move into becoming activism? And actually, you, Samantha, said that you have a rule in Solutions Journalism Network that it shouldn't be activism. And I respect that. But actually, there are more and more newsrooms or media companies who think it's a good idea and have decided to do it. And I'm going to show you examples of that and talk more about why they think it's an important and why it makes sense for them. But it is controversial. It is a pink elephant. But it's about time to start thinking about it, at least, and be inspired by others. So constructive journalism, as defined by the Windesheim University, where I currently work, looks like this. Six sentences, domains. We add a solution-oriented framing of news. Constructive journalism produces a perspective about the future, a productive perspective about the future. It's critical but never cynical. It asks new questions to power, so-called victims and experts. It uses data to create infographics explaining the news, so we go from covering an incident to providing more context. And the last one, which is the one I'm going to dive into now, and the reason why we have this panel, is constructive journalism aims to engage and empower the public and ultimately co-create with them. So I'm going to show you examples of that now. I have five nations, five newsrooms in five different countries that I want to highlight show you. In Denmark, this newspaper, Fyns Stiftstidende, it's a regional newspaper. It covers the middle part of Denmark, and it's a part of the second largest media company in Denmark. It's a part of a larger corporation. But they have for quite a few years, I think it's 5 years, been working with how can they, as a regional newspaper, become valuable again for the community, for the region that they are part of. And the answer for them is to actually become activists. And this article is exactly about that, quite a recent one about a news topic that is on everybody's mind, the refugee crisis. So this is an article from the 2nd of September last year, and the headline says, Fyns Stiftstidende helps. We are creating a job dating site for refugees on Facebook. So that's quite activistic. The newspaper is taking on the role to find jobs for the refugees that are in the region. And they do it for a long time. They've covered this as a campaign. and they are very clear on what their position is. So they created this Facebook group, which I hope will pop up. No? Let's see. Yeah, let's try this. Oh, okay. Sorry about that. Security. Let's go back. Well, so the newspaper took a stance. How can we help the refugees that are in our region? Can we connect them with the local community? Can we find jobs for them? We think it's a good idea. And this campaign is still going on. And this particular newspaper is saying, the editor-in-chief is saying, this is the reason why we have grown our amount of subscribers. It's one of the only newspapers, very few newspapers in Denmark who's not bleeding in a downward spiral in terms of subscribers. The editor-in-chief, Per Vestergaard, is saying, this is one of the reasons, I think it's the main part of the reason why we're no longer declining, but actually growing. And the responses from the community is, you create more value for us. We feel like we can engage more, it makes sense, it's valuable for the part of the country we live in. So thank you for that. In the UK, The Guardian, you of course all know that, launched a campaign covering climate change, Keep It in the Ground. Alan Rusbridger, the former editor-in-chief, was the main, you could say, he took the initiative to do this before he stepped down. So they had a very strong activistic element in that, because The Guardian was clear to the readers, here's what we think about climate change, here's what we think should be done, and please join forces with us to see it happen. And I want to play this video for you, which is the trailer. It's not a piece of journalism, it's just a trailer that The Guardian produced to introduce this campaign within journalism for their readers, listeners, and viewers. So I'm going to play it now, and I hope the sound works. Let's see.
We know that if we want to avoid catastrophic global warming, we need to reduce.
Okay, I'm going to stop it. Can we get the sound up a little? Yeah, I'm going to play it again. We'll try again.
We know that if we want to avoid catastrophic global warming, we need to reduce emissions. But it can be quite hard to get your head around how to do that. There's this really simple idea.
This stuff has to be kept in the ground. It cannot be dug up.
Because there's only one reason you get it out of the ground, and that is to burn it.
Leave it in the ground.
Keep oil in the soil and the coal in the hole.
That's Bill's simple proposition.
It's the only way forward.
You actually can't use the majority of the reserves that have been identified by fossil fuel companies.
So this idea of keeping it in the ground comes from Bill McKibben. And there are really three numbers that you need to know.
Three facts.
First is 2 degrees.
2 degrees.
2 degrees.
That is the threshold for dangerous climate change. The second number,
565,
is 565 gigatons.
Gigatons.
Now that's the amount of carbon dioxide that we can safely release into the atmosphere and still have a reasonable chance of staying below 2 degrees. That is kind of a carbon budget.
When you start getting beyond that,
things start getting really bad. And the third number, and this is kind of the scary number, is
2795 gigatons.
Now that's the amount of carbon dioxide that would be released if all of the fossil fuel reserves that we know about already were dug up and burned. You will have noticed that 2795 is a lot bigger than 565.
We have way more fossil fuel in the reserves than we could possibly burn.
If they were to burn those reserves, never mind ones they haven't yet explored, just the ones they've already identified, you would end up emitting so much carbon that you would produce catastrophic climate change.
Astonishingly.
Companies are still looking for more. And in fact, last year, I think they spent over 700 billion looking for more.
So there's a real tension there.
And while you are trying to persuade people to change their light bulbs and to drive less often or whatever it might be, if this stuff is still being pumped out of the ground, all those rather feeble measures are going to prove to be useless.
Were we to burn...
We can't actually burn...
...all the fossil fuels which are there, it would lead to inevitable disaster. There's not a question of it.
We should be tackling the fossil fuel companies directly. Leave it...
In the ground.
...on the ground.
This stuff has to be kept in the ground. It cannot be dug up.
It's the only way forward.
So nobody who watches this would be in doubt what is the stance of the Guardian. The Guardian feels that this stuff should stay in the ground. And they actively ask their readers to disinvest their stocks so they support companies that are not guided by this. It also targeted the world's two largest philanthropic organizations, the Wellcome Trust and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, to get them to act on this. So it was a very, very activistic approach by the Guardian, and also controversial. And when Alan Rusbridger was asked about this, how can you support this? This is not what journalism should do. His answer was, this is too important a topic for us to not have an active stance on. And the science is supporting what we are saying, an overwhelming amount of science, so we feel like we are on the right track. And as long as we are transparent about what it is we're doing, it's okay for a newspaper to do this. That was what they said. And going back to the examples, the correspondent, Dutch online media, very successful, growing rapidly, are very activistic in many of their stories. This is one example from last year. It's about changing banks. It's introducing to the readers from the correspondent. You see him in the corner. If we want to see good behavior in banks, we should be customers in banks that are not haven't behaved badly in the global meltdown. So maybe it's time for you to make up your mind which bank is yours. And if it's not living up to the ethics you think is valuable, maybe you should change bank. And that's what he introduces here. And that resulted in 10,000 Dutch people changing their bank. And this was only because of the correspondent's initiative and very activistic, engaging approach, you could say. I have two more examples, and then I'm done. In the US, there's this online media called Riot. Actually, you can see their vision here. It's a niche media, but it's very clear on how they stand on being activist and engaging. So the headline here, or their mission statement in one sentence, is every story lets you take action. So if you click down, let's just look at this one. They have a journalistic story about Islamophobia in the wake of terror attacks. You read it, and then they suggest how you can take action, if you want to take action on what you just read. Click the red button to learn more about UnHate, which is some organization. So that is linking journalistic story to an action you can take as a reader. The Christian Science Monitor, another newspaper in the US, is actually also doing some of the same. This is the front page. If you go over here, you'll notice here on the right-hand side, it says take action. This is the front page, the normal front page, but they have a section over here called take action. And if you click on that, you'll see that they invite their readers to be part of taking action on some of these big topics that they introduce: environment, education, conflict resolution, disaster relief and recovery, human trafficking, and so forth. So, yeah.
Thank you. What's the action they're asking people to take?
This one?
Yeah.
It's the same, as I understand it, they channel people over to an organization who is doing something about it.
Okay.
And the last one, I know there's a representative of this media in the room. In Germany, they are launching their first constructive... Oh, please, don't do this. Perspective Daily? That's strange. Anyway, I want to emphasize it because it's the first true constructive journalistic media being launched in Germany called Perspective Daily. They had a crowdfunding sourcing campaign looking for 12,000 members as a minimum. They've now surpassed that and are growing. They have 13,000 members at this point and will launch in May. And I expect that the engagement and empowerment part of it will be very close to their heart and the journalism that they do, and that's going to be exciting. So with that, I'm going to close my presentation, but I hope you got some ideas of media companies who are actively working with engagement, with empowerment, and with creating more value for the communities that they serve. So they're pioneers in this whole domain of engagement. Yeah. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Beh, grazie a tutti. Intanto volevo, siamo stati un po' lunghi anche per colpa mia, volevo chiedere se ci sono domande, fatele pure, ovviamente. E nel frattempo volevo, qui ce n'è una, lì un'altra, lì un'altra. Volevo, mentre arriva il microfono, volevo ringraziare le due traduttrici che sono nella camera oscura lì e che mi hanno mandato in cielo perché... per facilitare il fatto che ciascuno di noi si possa esprimere al meglio, abbiamo scelto di parlare in entrambe le lingue, l'italiano e l'inglese, che poi sono le lingue con cui si parla di giornalismo in tutto il mondo, grazie al Festival di Perugia e a tante manifestazioni in inglese. Quindi le domande, prima?
I was wondering if there was a lot of potential for, say, solutions journalism and constructive journalism in post-conflict situations. So in Northern Ireland, our media is divided along ethnic lines, and peace journalism has been advocated, and it's not working. And I was wondering, could constructive journalism, could solutions journalism do what peace journalism can't?
So a short answer on that. I am not super literate about the inner structures of peace journalism, but what is guiding our work with constructive journalism is this emotional understanding of what emotions engages. How could you put that knowledge into the way you present your stories and what you emphasize in your stories? So the emotion of awe is a highly engaging emotion. It trumps negative emotions like fear and anger and sadness. So if you know that, that's from a big study that was done. If you know that, how can you activate that when you do your reporting or in the discussion or the debate you engage with? And that is guiding our work in constructive journalism. And I hope that it will prove more effective than what you're talking about. Because it's very important.
And it's hard to know without knowing what the coverage has been to comment on that, but the power also, as Cathrine was saying, the power of solutions journalism, of constructive journalism, is that it doesn't have to be located in your community. It can be reported stories from any other post-conflict zone in the world, and Northern Ireland's ability to take insight from that. As I said, insight, not inspiration. So really taking those learnings and bringing them back. You know, there are tons of cases in which effective programs and organizations to working in post-conflict zones and things that are working that if they're reported on, that, you know, then Northern Ireland can learn from those stories. It doesn't have to be local, it can be from anywhere.
One thing I would add to that as well is the as a resource is a organization called Images of Voices of Hope. You can go to it by ivoh.org. And they've coined the term restorative narrative as a way to look at ways we can modify our journalism or look at journalism in a different light to really become more restorative. Again, it's the taking on the genius of the and, right? It's really trying to look at different perspectives. So, you know, what's pretty innovative at the University of Oregon is, you know, we've embraced a lot of our different approaches. One of them actually was solution journalism. We have a professor kind of teaching that within their curriculum. One other professor is also looking at restorative narrative as a curricula, course as well, in looking at how we want to change our coverage. One of the things that a real response to that has been, anybody following US news, specifically Oregon news, back in October there was actually a shooting at one of the community colleges near the University of Oregon. And a group of students and faculty actually went there months afterwards and did an interview with the community to kind of get a sense of, you know, where they were in terms of an approach of restorative narrative. And one of the insights that they gathered was the fact that in one of the interviews, you know, a community member actually said that after such dire incidences there in their community, having the media parachute in and cover that story, you know, national level community or national level media parachuting in, you know, that was like their second trauma, as they would say. It affected their community again, and not in a positive way, not in a constructive or solution-oriented way. So I think it's healthy of us to think of ways we can cover our news differently and kind of look at the restorative approaches.
Okay, thank you. Prima sarebbe... Vabbè. Ok. Lui è per lì. No, colpa mia. Sì.
Hi. I got a question concerning activism and journalism. Like, after you presented those different examples, and you even mentioned that for the Danish newspaper it's some kind of a business model to have a bigger growth in sales. Shouldn't there be like a transparency in the agenda of each newspaper or each company and some guidelines? Because otherwise I see there's a big risk of just like constantly changing your activism regarding to the fields that you feel there's the biggest growth in readers.
I think you're totally right, because that is why it's controversial. Exactly what you say, if it's not transparent. So the media companies who chooses to do this, the examples that I showed, maybe I didn't emphasize it enough, say that they have been very transparent. You know, when they launch it, they have like a little column or a little box saying, this is part of our so-and-so, here's what we, this newspaper, think about it. So it's kind of labeled like that. And that's the transparency that I think you're talking about. But it is controversial and not, I mean, it's not something that everybody agrees on. But the ones that do it because of the reasons that I talked about.
Per quanto riguarda invece l'informazione italiana, dove, passatemi l'espressione, il mercato dell'indignazione e anche dei commenti ai pezzi, piuttosto che degli interventi sui social, è così violento e anche un po' scoraggiante, no? Secondo voi questo tipo di, appunto, giornalismo costruttivo potrebbe avere un successo reale? È veramente un dubbio, non è una provocazione.
E rispondiamo noi italiani?
Sì, anche se mi sembra che in questa sala abbiamo l'onore di avere Mario Tedeschini, che è più titolato di me a rispondere a questa domanda perché ha uno sguardo più lungo. Allora, io quello che posso dirvi è che c'è una bellissima equazione che noi architetti dell'informazione usiamo e abbiamo sempre a mente, che è questa, e non è nostra, è di uno psicologo cognitivo, e che dice che non puoi cambiare le persone, ma puoi agire sul loro comportamento configurando, progettando l'ambiente in cui queste persone si troveranno a interagire. Ora, io ritengo che gran parte dei problemi di trolling, diciamo così, che abbiamo, che possiamo registrare nei thread dei commenti italiani soprattutto, deriva dal fatto che questi ambienti, cioè il luogo dove si commenta e dove si interagisce, uno, sono abbandonati a loro stessi, due, non sono stati progettati per premiare i comportamenti virtuosi. Perché se fosse stato così, c'è un bellissimo esempio che fa Shirky, Clay Shirky, a proposito di Wikipedia, no? Quando dici perché funziona Wikipedia e non sono superiori diciamo perché non prendono il sopravvento le azioni negative all'interno di quell'ambiente. Perché lui dice è un po' come se in una città i muri delle case avessero una vernice speciale per cui ogni volta che uno passa e fa un tag o un graffito, questo non fa presa e scivola giù. Oppure è come questa stessa città in cui però ognuno che passa può anche avere una gomma da cancellare gigantesca per cui arriva lì davanti, fa così e quel graffito viene cancellato. Quindi io metterei la questione in termini di ambiente e di ecosistema, però sarei veramente curioso di sentire come la pensa Mario Tedeschini Lalli, che è qua. Ti va?
Sì. E poi Cathrine.
Can I ask just quickly, you who asked the question, how come you think it's not applicable in Italy? I just need to understand what you're thinking. Why wouldn't it be applicable in Italian media? What's your concern? Can you summarize?
She's talking about what happens around the information that is full of hate.
Ah, okay.
Forse vorrei aggiungere una frase che non è mia, ma ho trovato preparandomi a questo dibattito. Non so se forse di Cathrine. Cioè, le persone urlano in genere quando non hanno voce, quando gli viene negata spesso la voce. Questo è un po' riconducibile a quello che dicevo prima, quindi creare delle piattaforme e dei luoghi dove le persone possano trovare la loro voce forse è un'azione mitigante rispetto a quello che stavi dicendo. Ci richiamano all'ordine?
Sì, un'altra domanda. Ci sono altre domande? O una...
And then just one additional comment, then I would never deign to know anything about Italian media, but constructive journalism, solutions journalism, you're showing how different players are coming together to attack a problem. And you're not pitting people against each other, and you're not trying to tear down an institution or an individual. You're showing how people are kind of the forward thinking, the positive movement toward something that's working. And I think instinctively people are more willing to engage with that because there are no bad guys. There are always trolls. There are always going to be people who are going to attack anything, but I think it creates a much less divisive conversation.
Sì, salve. Io volevo chiedervi in che modo si può finanziare il giornalismo costruttivo? Mi spiego, certamente si può finanziare con i canali, come dire, in maniera classica e tradizionale, però spesso vediamo nei media anche un uso aggressivo e molto, molto invadente della pubblicità, vediamo appunto Mi vengono in mente esempi di, non so, vendita dei dati e quindi poi queste pagine completamente piene di pubblicità che chiaramente disturbano l'utente. Cioè, quello che voglio chiedervi è se non bisogna anche pensare a una modalità di finanziamento che sia anche più etica e che sia più costruttiva rispetto a questi temi, perché se poi, come dire, l'utente ha l'impressione di vivere una realtà come dire, che ha un fine economico, forse siamo sempre un po' punti a capo. Cioè, chiedo se questa cosa viene contemplata.
Vi chiedo soltanto di essere brevi perché siamo un po' in ritardo e così finiamo rapidamente. Grazie.
I have a clear suggestion or answer on that. The Dutch media, The Correspondent, is entirely crowdfunded. So it has no advertisers, it has no other funding than the membership fees from people who want to support that kind of journalism. And they hold the world record in crowdfunding. So I think that tells us that there's a need or a want for a journalism that has this kind of approach. I think they are the prime example of that. So that's something to be inspired about.
Ok, grazie a tutti. Cercheremo di condividere tutte le slide di oggi. Il video sarà visibile online, diciamo, come tutti quelli del festival. Grazie ancora.